Sirius XM Radio. It's the Opie and Anthony Show. We are live. It's July 30th to prove it. We got Mel Karmazin coming in about 5 or 10 minutes. Rich, when you see a guy with like white hair and dark eyebrows, that's your cue to get the fuck out of here. We gotta look like we're smart today.
Oh, please. I'm going to put on my real smart fucking face today.
Yeah, you are. Outside the studio.
It's a mask of someone else's face.
Yeah, please.
Outside the studio. I'm not even kidding.
Really?
Yeah, you're going to dumb this down. We got to get into some things with Mel Karmazin. We got to see if we're going to be part of the new company. We got things to do.
What if he recognizes me or
he's not going to recognize
you? He might be a fan of mine. You don't know that.
He's not a fan of yours.
Why
do
you ask
him
when he gets here?
Russell Simmons didn't know you.
Why would he know you?
He might know me. A lot of people watch TV. I've been on a lot of TV.
He would recognize you if you were a bigwig down on Wall Street. He knows those guys. He doesn't see like faces when it comes to celebrities.
He ran Viacom.
What's that?
Exactly. He's a company.
What's that?
He's a dunce.
And the place smells good. It looks good.
Wicklund swab the deck.
Donnie Wicklund's up here in a suit, and Master Poe's up here in a suit.
Trying to keep their job. I wouldn't be surprised Poe makes him fill out paperwork.
I was just thinking that.
Fill out your paperwork, and then take a seat on the bleachers.
Yes. We cleaned up the cockroaches. The place looks very good. I know the guys worked hard on it.
Wow, look at the sign out there, huh?
Sirius XM.
Look at that.
Oh, yeah.
Man. Who thought we'd ever see the day?
Did the deal go through?
Exactly. Do you understand what's happening here?
Hold on.
Did the deal go through?
I mean, is it, we understand what you mean.
Look at the sign.
Did they close? That's what I'm saying.
No, they didn't. We're traitors. We're actually, we're secretly shipping tapes to Sirius. Yeah. They're two separate companies.
What are you?
Well, I thought it was going to take months.
It took 18 months.
It took like a year and a half.
Rich, what? Really?
This is
I'm serious.
I know you're serious.
I was reading.
This is Sirius XM Radio, so you're in the right place.
As of right now. Right now.
Yeah, as of yesterday, the day before. The second the deal went through.
Yes, they have signed the paperwork.
Can someone let us know when say that a certain boss is on the elevator so we can make empty a certain seat?
Yeah.
Thanks. Yeah.
And I don't want it. I want it to be done violently. Okay. If you could humor me with that, Mars.
Okay. Wow.
You have to leave.
I will. Maybe for a few, I'll go out.
Yeah, you're just too
what?
Stupid to be in the same room.
No, but here's the thing, Rich. We love you, but you'll make some kind of a joke. You'll say something that makes us go, we really don't like him that much.
Yeah.
We'll have to defend ourselves.
Exactly.
Where I go, that happens.
Exactly.
That's why we didn't have an audience here. We're trying to play this one right. No audience, no dummies, just me, Anthony, and Jim Norton.
He's going to be here the whole
time, is he? He'll probably do an awkward 10 minutes and get the fuck out.
Well, then I'll come back in.
All right, you can do that.
Hey, guys, I'm going to leave now. I have something to
do. Look, we don't care what you do before or after.
Yeah. We're not concerned with your plans.
It's the during part.
Yeah.
You know, when he's in here, you can't really be in here. Yeah. You didn't even know if the deal went through.
You didn't know what Viacom was.
This is
one for the adults, Rich.
Listen, I'm serious. When it comes to this kind of shit, I'm good at it.
You're not good at what? Are you? Am scraying? Getting out? Let's hope so.
When it comes to meetings and big wigs.
Yeah.
How many times have you been told to leave or just quiet? Has Bonnie told you that at pitch meetings? Like, you just shut up. You just don't talk.
The last pitch meeting we had last week, perfect.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Why don't you leave?
Now, he's probably only a couple. Give me time.
To do what?
I'm going to leave.
Why don't you go downstairs and be a lookout? And you can phone us when he comes in.
Right.
You just be the lookout guy.
That's right. This is great.
That's an important position.
Finally.
Yeah.
It's been like 7 years since I've become here, and I'm finally getting kicked out.
No one's kicking you out.
You know, I should be. I wouldn't want the pressure of sitting here when he's in here.
It's not kicked out. It was just the thing was that when this came down.
Yeah, I don't blame. Hey, listen.
No, everyone is saying, Rich, get the fuck out. Now, everybody on instant feedback.
They're only allowing me to stay out of a sense of loyalty.
Really?
Yes, of course. Yeah, Danny is here.
Mel is extremely intimidating. Extremely.
Not if you have nothing to lose like me.
No, I'm telling you.
You have a wife and three kids. What do you mean you have nothing to lose? You have everything to lose.
I'm a rebel.
Exactly. You're not Jimmy Dean.
Yeah.
You're an older gentleman.
You have things to lose.
Yes, exactly.
You have two families.
Cold coffee. You suck.
Jimmy, someone's saying that you sound nervous. Are you nervous?
No.
I'm just pointing out what's going on.
No, I actually feel okay. I feel fine.
All right. You know what? I'm going to scram now. Maybe I'll go do some commercials or something. And, oh, you know how we do the commercials here for my gigs and stuff?
Are you still talking?
Yeah.
Why don't you go?
Hey, do you really have season 5 of The Wire?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, I swear
to
God.
I have all of them.
Not 5. It hasn't come out yet.
No, I swear
to
God.
Why would I say all of them? Would he say not 5?
You have
not
5,
too? Though.
Well, because 5 hasn't been released yet. But yeah, we got Roland that, you know, gets this stuff for us, so we're prepared for interviews.
Yeah.
He's all in the elevator?
All right, get out of here.
Yeah, oh, my God.
Look at Rich. Rich, leave. Just leave. Remember, this is light and airy. It's a how do you do, not an inquisition.
Look at Anthony. He's the one that's nervous.
Light and airy.
Look, Eric Logan, he gave me a speech yesterday. He goes, could you please be Greg Hughes and not Opie?
Exactly.
And look, Eric Logan, don't F it up. They're coming in like crazy. Another one from Logan. Tell Rich to get the fuck out.
Yeah. Yeah, we had to
this
tell
is a pretty
Rich
big
to get out of
thing
there.
Here. Where do you want
no,
him?
No, over there.
No, I'm sitting next
nope.
to you.
Don't screw with me. Right
then
there.
You better remove that chair because I'm going to have him take a seat right there.
Oh, that's the good spot right there. You got it.
That's not good. That means he's close to me. Yeah. I want him to be
nah,
close
but
over
like,
there.
That's a better seat because this way you're kind of looking over the whole thing.
Oh, is it good?
Yeah, I think so.
All right, then, Ant, switch seats with me.
Nope.
Please?
I'm staying right here. I'm right here.
I think it's very funny that the instant feedbackers were even turning on Voss. Just
oh, yeah.
Everybody.
Get him out.
Voss is the worst. You don't want him around.
Mm-hmm.
Guy's kryptonite.
What is Mel's...
Success kryptonite.
What's Mel's opening line going to be?
Hello.
Yeah.
Nah, he's...
Hey, Eric Logan just... Elo just sent me a text, too. Tell Voss to get out.
Yeah, everyone's saying it. Where did Rich go?
Right there.
No, Rich, hide.
Oh, Rich, get out of here,
no, let him
please,
look through the
Rich.
Window. Let him look through the window. I don't mind if Rich looks through the window.
Yeah.
God, Rich.
Voss can stare through the window, but he can't speak.
Oh, no, he's too creepy looking anyway, yeah. Rich.
We'll just tell everybody he's a listener.
Rich is like a hyena. Oh, no, Rich is shaking hands with him.
Yeah.
They kicked me out.
He was hoping Mel would go, wait, I know you.
Yeah.
Wait, haven't I seen you on something?
No, he doesn't know you. Please. Here he is. It's Mel Karmazin.
Mel,
have a seat.
How are you, Jim?
Jim, nice to see you.
Hi. Anthony, how are you, sir?
I didn't know that.
Hey, Mel, how are you?
Who's this other person?
Greg Hughes, we like to call him.
It's Greg Hughes today.
We don't like the Opie character much, so Greg Hughes today, I think,
yes,
is more
good.
Fitting.
And did you purposely give me a chair that's down so low?
Why isn't Mel's chair up higher?
No, if that was the strategy, I understand, and I'm happy to deal with it. And also headsets that don't sort of fit on
instantly.
Your head. So
why is this not?
I assume the company you work for has not given you the resources. That
well,
you need.
No. Mel, that's something I'd like to talk to you about. Yes, they've been. We call them skinflints.
Is that the point?
They've been a little stingy.
We have a cockroach problem in this building. A major cockroach problem.
And it was before you guys got there?
Perhaps a couple
is that
of...
Is that a new problem?
It's
or is
been
that
multiplying for the last, I don't know,
it could
two
be
years?
The material that comes out of the speakers.
Sure. Mel, you trimmed down since the last time we saw you.
I've been on a hunger strike trying to get the deal done.
Yeah.
So I knew that making good arguments to the regulators didn't work, so I tried anything. I thought they'd be sympathetic if they knew that there was a poor guy who's getting, you know, IV feeding, you know, in a cell, you know, but at the end of the day, they did the right thing.
Did you think it was going to take this long, honestly?
Well, a couple questions on that. One is, did I think it would get done? And I believed it should get done, but throughout the whole process, I really questioned whether it will get done.
I mean, I think everybody was.
And there were legitimate reasons for concern based on a lot of the stuff, you know, that you read. Did I think it would take this long? Absolutely not. Because, you know, I mean, maybe I'm making it simplistic. I mean, it's, okay, you got two satellite radio companies. Either you believe that they compete with a whole lot of other things, and if they do, no big deal. Okay, and if you think that there's a separate market, you know, called satellite radio, and oh my God, having only one company in satellite radio is bad, then you should be able to conclude that in a rather short period of time.
Yeah, it shouldn't have taken so long. I think you proved a good point, too, by saying and pointing out early on that it does compete with everything else, with all this other medium out there. And I think now it's more obvious than it was even when we tried to get this thing started. But it's a little more obvious now. But back then, it was kind of hard to sell them on the fact that, yes, this is competing with iPods and iPhones and everything else.
Well, you said when we got this thing going. You were
in
cahoots with
Mel.
It was you and Mel getting this thing done.
Late night phone calls.
I've been getting, obviously, emails every time my name gets mentioned on the show. So yeah. I'm assuming everything that you guys have done has been done to help get this merger.
Absolutely.
You guys have been part of the team.
Yes, we're
getting
I'll be honest with you, Mel. It's more what we didn't say than what we did say to get this merger through, to tell you
the
truth.
That's pretty tough, because I heard something that they said, and I didn't think there was anything left that wasn't said. But let me get to your point. And one of the things that I was hopeful of, and I even told our board 17 months ago that this would be very important, was that we needed the broadcasters to be very aggressive in opposing the merger.
The NAB, yeah.
Thank God, because if in fact their strategy were smarter and the NAB didn't try to oppose it, we had the benefit now of all of these people saying, stop the monopoly, stop the monopoly. And the smart people in Washington are saying, well, gee, if this is a monopoly, why do you care?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? I mean, the fact that you care and the fact that you've spent so much money and the fact that, terrestrial radio broadcasters have lobbied so hard proves that we're in a competitive market that would at least include the 10,000 AM/FM radio stations. So add to that the technology changes that continue to go on, internet radio, iPhones, whatever is out there, and there'll be more. So the fact that this merger occurred is great news, but there's still a tremendous amount of competitors out there that we compete with.
Sure. You were on the other side of it for a short time, too, when satellite radio started taking hold on regular radio. And
tried to kill
to
kill it.
You absolutely. I remember the ads that would run, and it was all about bashing it and trying to. So you obviously had great insight on what a threat it was.
Yeah, I mean, I couldn't see any good reason why satellite radio was necessary, coming from a very, very successful, one of the largest, if not the largest, terrestrial radio company. There was nothing in it for me with satellite radio.
Right.
All I knew is that when you got into your car, you had an AM and an FM button. The last thing I wanted you to have was an XM button.
Another
that was
button,
the
right.
last thing I wanted. The worst nightmare came when satellite radio not just came together, but really started to grow. And the broadcasters, in not liking competition, talk about people who want a monopoly, not wanting competition, did everything they could do to make us fail. I mean, their goal was not to just stop the merger. Right. The reason they wanted to stop the merger, if you think about it, I mean, why would stop the merger matter? There'd still be satellite radio, there'd still be XM, there'd still be Sirius. The reason they wanted to stop it is they believed standalone we would be weaker, maybe fail. Now, I mean, I've spoken to the management of XM throughout this process, and they believed that XM would not fail. I mean, I didn't run the company, didn't know enough about it. I can assure you, you never assure anybody of anything, but I can tell you, I strongly believe there was no risks associated with Sirius not making it.
Right, you'd still be going merger or not.
I mean, it may take a year or two more to make a profit. I mean, at some point, you got to make a profit, right? But the fact is that the broadcaster's hope was not just that the merger wouldn't happen, okay? That would be a step in the right direction, but satellite radio would disappear.
Yeah, go away.
These same broadcasters were the ones that fought against cable television. So when, it was just the broadcast networks and stuff like that, and cable was coming in, the NAB lobbied against cable. They lobbied against satellite television. So that's what they do. And that's,
yeah. I never got the idea of how they could say that it's not competing, that it's a monopoly if the companies merge, but hey, we're not competing with them. Yet, we are trying everything in our power to keep them down and destroy them. And
one of the things they did, which I can't tell you how much influence it had, because I really don't know, because it really got down to the very end, and it's 2-2, and is this thing going to happen and stuff. They put a banner on their building. They have this, you know, they have a lot of money, right? All the broadcasters, you know, put the money to them. And they had a banner on their building that said, "Stop the monopoly," okay? And we took pictures of it, right? And we sent it to everybody who was on our list, because our viewpoint was the fact that they're doing it. I mean, you know, they're not lobbying every merger that goes on. Mm-hmm. Well, why the hell should they care?
Yeah.
Why
should,
if we are a duopoly on our way to a monopoly, by definition, they're not in that pie.
Right.
And the fact that they, thank goodness for it, you know, and my hat's off to the head of the NAB. I think that
David Weir.
I think we all owe him a, but you know, when Saturday, when I finally get to celebrate on this merger, I will be toasting him first before I toast anyone
basically
else.
What Mel's doing right now, he's rubbing it in. He's, yeah, why not?
How happy are
and
you?
And why not?
If I knew he was listening, I would be doing more, but
sure.
I'm just assuming. I'm just telling you the guys.
The word's going to get out there, and you're rubbing it.
I'm just giving this.
Was there a most frustrating thing like that happened? Because like for a while they were like, "Yeah, it's going to go through. It could be any day. It could be any day. It could be any week," and then it wouldn't happen. Was there one thing that happened during this whole process where you were like, "This is a major problem"?
I thought this was a major problem every step of the way because they made it a major problem. But I never was the one saying it's going to be any day. So it was the press. It was different people saying it. So I sort of knew what was going on. And I never knew, and it wasn't going to be over until it was over. So on Friday of last week, we got word that the third commissioner, at that point it was 2-2, and we got word that the third commissioner had voted for the merger. But I still had not gotten the official notice that said the FCC had approved it.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't, so I wasn't even celebrating at that point. So it wasn't until we got the final word, which was about 4:00 on Monday, and then we had to finish raising a bunch of money that we needed because I don't want to get complicated, but XM had a bunch of debt. We needed to raise $1.25 billion to refinance that debt that was a change of control. This market, you know, is sort of not a great market to raise money in. So until Monday night at 7:00, when we got the money, did I finally press the button to close the merger, and we closed it by 8:00. But it was, you know, a long process, including 4 congressional hearings. A senator met with me privately and said that if I would agree to apply the same indecency rules broadcast radio has, that he would support the merger.
A senator very close to the NAB, probably, one of those?
A senator, very influential senator that obviously close to the NAB, as a lot of them are, because, again, I mean, the NAB is, you know, with all due respect, is probably one of the most powerful lobbying organizations in Washington.
Mm-hmm.
All of the congressmen and senators spend an awful lot of money and want to get reelected, and the television stations and the radio stations are very important for them, and they're in their community, and they're, you know, they represent their constituency. So with all due respect, you know, for the, you know, congressional process, there were many people who were against the merger. And these, as far as the congressmen who wrote letters and the senators who wrote letters, they're helping their constituents. I mean, they don't feel that they're doing something to interfere with our merger. They're saying, if somebody who is in my district is having a problem, I'm going to try to help that person that's in my district.
How do you answer somebody, though, that says that they want to put the same restrictions in place and FCC regulations on satellite radio?
Well, very simple. The answer is just no.
Very good.
It was,
nice.
It was
nice
really
to hear. Okay.
I mean, it was just really, it was not a long discussion about it. And if I needed to elaborate, is that you know, people have decided that they want to pay $12.95 a month. That it's not over the air broadcasting where you're worried about, you know, children listening. That this is a pay service, and it would be the same argument that MTV has, or the same argument that HBO has, or you know, any of the you know, cable channels have. So unless someone was going to try to enact a law that said that you couldn't, you know, broadcast these words and these discussions on cable or satellite television and satellite radio. And if the Supreme Court were to uphold that, then it would become law. But for that happening, there's nothing the FCC could do or anything like that, nor should they do it.
Hey, let's get to the bottom of the issue here. Did you or did you not bring pink slips for us?
No, no.
Pink slips.
You know,
a lot of people I know Mel. He's going there just to fire the guys. Well, which I would laugh really hard about, by the way.
Well, no, I mean, it didn't hurt you that I did that once.
Yeah.
I mean, that was a very profitable deal for you guys.
That was kind of fun.
I mean, anyway,
this is the first time we've seen you since that whole awful thing went down 6 years ago, by the way. We have not been in contact. First time we've talked. And Ann and I are very used to meeting you when we were in trouble. We never had the nice meeting.
We had one nice meeting in the office upstairs.
Well, you guys just weren't nice. So what would happen would be that I was always this charming, nice guy, and you guys would just be dicks and come up into my office and be the way you guys are.
They can be dicks.
That's Jim Norton, by the way.
If someone has to get fired, a lot of us could stay.
How satisfying was it to watch Eric Logan run out of the building with his tail between his legs before you got there?
Oh, and let me tell you, I was a big, and still am, a huge Eric Logan fan. Eric worked for me in terrestrial radio.
Well, I'm talking about the Eric Logan that works for XM.
Well, no, I think he has grown and gotten more experience. I saw Eric yesterday, and I am absolutely a fan. And as a matter of fact, Eric has decided that he was going to move on. But had Eric not made that decision, there was a very important position, and he knows it.
The trash has to go out. I understand. Yeah, it does have to be taken out of the building.
Out with the old, in with the new.
And the windows have to be washed, and it's a very important position.
So you guys are not Eric Logan fans?
No, we love Logan.
He actually kept us safe the last 4 years.
No, he's a great friend.
We finally decided, Mel, after the big fuck-up, that we were going to, listen to somebody, finally.
Nah. Then I'll bring the pink slips out. Because you guys listening to somebody is something I don't think would exactly work.
When you sit out 2 years, 3 months, you have a lot of time to think, and you're like, you know what, maybe it's time to listen to somebody in this business.
And by the way, you know, I mean, because every time you guys talked about me, people made it a point.
Oh, it's entertainment, Mel. You understand that.
I absolutely do. No, I absolutely do.
And they probably got it wrong in the translation.
They made it a point to give me, you know, the tapes of it, right? So I'm aware of it. But the one thing, as I said, I think that was unclear, is that I followed the contract. In other words, if in fact...
You're a contract guy. You always have been.
But if, in fact, there was a contract that basically said that, you know, we didn't have the right to take you off the air.
Believe me. Then
that would have been a scummy thing to do.
There was a point we wished you didn't follow the contract because we wanted to work again.
Well, yeah. So, I mean, the fact that we were smart, insofar as designing a contract that provided us with the ability to do what we did was honorable, may not have been liked by you, and I wouldn't like it at all. I mean, I totally agree. And
why
didn't
you let us work again? Well, why did you make us sit out for 2 years? Well, were we competition at that point?
Absolutely. I thought you guys were terrifically talented. I mean, I sort of was involved in hiring you, right?
Yeah.
I mean, okay.
Yeah. Remember that.
So at this point, I thought that you guys were absolutely terrific. I thought that you were great talent. And why on earth, if I can pay you not to compete with me, would I want you to compete? So on one hand,
that was frustrating.
On one hand, well, talk
the
to
money
your
was good.
Not, I don't
the
know who wrote
great,
the, I don't know who wrote the contract, but if you didn't want me to be able to do that, it shouldn't have been in the contract that you guys signed.
Who read those things though?
Who reads those things?
Well, that's good to know.
Pages.
That's good to know. So no, I mean, I thought that decision was an easy one, even during the process, somebody came along and said, well, you know, what if we gave you some money, you know, to let you out? And, you know, that
and
concept.
And other things. There was a, whatever.
Yeah, there was a bunch of other things.
I don't want to rehash
stuff. But none of them.
It was a tough thing to sign.
They didn't give me enough of an incentive.
Right.
To not have you compete. I
don't want to bring up the reason why we had to meet with you, but it's one of our favorite stories in radio ever. We fucked up many times, but on this particular occasion, we got the call that we had to see you on January 2nd. This city was cleared out. There was no one in Manhattan. And Anthony and I walk up to your huge office, and you made us wait 20 minutes, which was very calculated. I'm wiping my hand because I'm sweating. Like, I don't want to, you know, he can't see me sweat. And then you walked in with the most classic line ever. You want to say that?
Oh, that one. Yeah, yeah. That was, the question's boggled me for years.
Yeah,
it's not really a question.
There's no real answer to this question.
No answer to it. It was, what time do you wake up in the morning and decide you're going to fuck Mel Carmen? Yeah. And I'm like, that isn't even, it's already been predetermined that you're gonna. It's just, what time is it?
So the reason I kept you waiting is I needed to have the right opening line. So it's,
oh, that was it. Were you practicing the line in your office?
So you got to just give me a clue as to what the subject was at this time.
It was a Howard thing.
Oh, okay. So here was the deal.
We're really trying not to go down that road.
Well,
right,
I don't
now,
know.
But it was a Howard thing. And Ant and I were sitting there like, do we answer? Do we say 10 o'clock? Do we say 11? Do we say we don't do this?
Yeah.
What was the answer to that question?
There's
well,
no answer.
I don't know. I guess the answer is that you guys don't sleep a lot. I thought you had a death wish. In other words, I just assumed you had a death wish because I had made it very clear that, we're in, this is a business, okay? And in this business, we make a whole bunch of money, a whole lot of money from Howard Stern. Just a tremendous amount. As a matter of fact, when CBS let him go, their revenue, $200 million
right.
affected when Howard left.
Sure.
Good or bad, $200 million. Sure. Why on earth would I want anybody, okay, anybody who works for me to hurt me insofar as hurting my money? So I didn't see from, you know, you guys got a First Amendment right, but I got a First Amendment right as to what goes on my radio stations. So you got a right to say things, and I got a right to not have you say it, and we then have a point. So it wasn't, if you guys made...
And that's where the death wish was, because we wanted to just fight it out.
And you wanted to
sit
there...
We were brave enough to just fight it out and figured, you know, he's strong enough that he could just fight back.
Oh, he could, but the winner would have been Clear Channel, and the winner would have been...
You think?
Of course, because you divide and you diminish... Let's assume there's a scenario. Okay,
right.
And let's take your scenario where you might, I don't know whether you'd ever have damaged Howard, but let's assume the attempt was to do that, and therefore you accomplished it, and you took something away from Howard. That would make, when we went to advertisers, because we were getting a whole lot of money there, we would get less, and who would get more would be these other broadcasters that we competed with, because we were as prepared to sell you in the same way, and, you know, we had general managers that worked for you. So I think it was just misguided. I mean, I think, in my opinion, it's sort of the team, you're on a team, okay,
right.
And instead of worrying about the opponent, you're fighting with the guys on the team. And forget whether Howard, I mean, if you know, I could have a conversation with Howard about what he did as well. But for this conversation here, you guys decided to fight with the quarterback, okay? You know, as important as you guys were on the team, and you decided, instead of worrying about going after Scott Shannon or going after
Went all those guys. We went after everybody. I just want to...
So much more mature now, though, Mel, and that's water under the bridge.
Does that mean the shows have become more boring? I hope not.
I never thought I'd be asking about congressional hearings to lighten it up. No, this is fun.
This is good, though. I think it's really good. I just want to... One more point, we can move on.
Yeah.
I just want to let you know that at the time, our goal was to make sure Howard didn't hurt our stock. That was the only thing we weren't actually trying to, you know, knock him out of the game. We were making sure he wasn't going to knock us out of the game. And that's where the confusion was, because we saw growing up what he did to other radio shows, and it was ugly, man. These guys had massive ratings in their cities and stuff, and Howard was able to just wipe them off the map. That scared the shit out of us when we came to New York into his backyard, and that was our whole goal going into that. Maybe it got confusing, and there was a gray area, but our whole thing was, let's make sure he doesn't do to us what he did to DiBella and the rest of them.
And that's the area that I think that you guys and I had a disagreement. Because you guys thought, okay, that he was doing that, okay? And maybe he did, okay? In other words, I did not hear that or sense that, okay? Mm-hmm. And I had told you had a, as a matter of fact, the program director, so that when you guys left, it wasn't about me dumping it on you guys. The general manager left. Everybody who was responsible
for the
left.
Sex or Sam thing.
And I, and because not so much that event, but the sense was that I had made clear what would work in our company, okay? And it appeared that there was a willful violation of what I had made clear to the general manager at the time would be acceptable. So if Howard was violating anything that you thought was hurting your brand and hurting you, That didn't come to me. It came to me, you know, when you guys reacted on the air.
Yeah.
And
but anyway, so
that
I understand.
But that was the history.
I just wanted to finally get my point out there, whether it's right or wrong. That's really what our thinking was back then.
Huh? I like the other idea that said you guys had a death wish. I think that. I think rather you. Well,
we sort of
he's
did.
Heard
you, you see where you put us, NEW? I mean, you could have helped us out a little bit.
He's heard.
You
could
put us on Howard
times.
Station in New York, and we wouldn't have had a death wish. Well, that would have been amazing for everybody involved.
And as a matter of fact,
NEW sucked except for our show.
So
and Ron Fez, who started doing a really good job at the end there.
So do you remember Tom Chisano?
Sure.
Oh, sure.
Didn't you work for Tom?
Yeah, we love Tom now.
Tom's great.
We used to hate that guy.
Tom is great and remains a good friend.
We love Tom.
Tom was the general manager of that radio station.
He used to call us up.
Tom did not want you guys on the I'll tell you, it wasn't because of your talent. Didn't want you on in the afternoon because he believed that he had a controversial morning show that some advertisers weren't going to advertise on. Yeah. So he wanted a station that would have an ability to have those national advertisers someplace else.
Right.
So it was Tom, because in my opinion, from a image point of view, from a brand point of view, I mean, it would have become what, in essence, Howard did with his channel, you know, on the other satellite radio company.
You could say Sirius. You own it now.
Well, no, I know I could say it. I just don't want to, you know, disrupt your listeners.
We've been saying the other company for too long. It's Sirius XM Radio.
No, but I mean, I think that, you know, Howard, you know, had a vision for a channel that would have all kinds of content that would be really compelling and, you know, very different than everyone else. And it would have fit perfectly, but the advertising scenario wasn't attractive.
I remember one nice meeting we had with you, and man, Mel had the best office in Manhattan, the greatest view ever. You saw 9/11 happen from your office.
I'll never forget.
We talked about that, but you were like, man, I just wish you guys and Howard would just get along, and you know, maybe I could somehow get you guys together, and you were starting to try to figure something out.
And now we're one big happy
family.
And
then we did the Sex with Sam thing. Well, we're just, you know, getting some of this out, and then we can move on with the future.
But more importantly, is Charlie Rose a nice guy? You did a hell of an interview on Charlie Rose.
I'll tell you, I've known Charlie for a long time, and he is a hell of a guy, and he's a great interviewer. And I just did CNBC before I came over here, and you get like 6 minutes, you know?
Yeah.
And the idea is, I mean, I want to talk. I mean, you know, I mean, if I'm going to be interviewed, I don't want to have a soundbite. And Charlie gives you an hour, and it's great, and he's smart, and he's terrific.
He's not intimidated by anybody. I watched him talk to Schwarzenegger and Bloomberg together, and you know, he agreed with them in certain things. He holds a paper and puts his hand up, and he'd stop them, and he'd get like a real interview. It wasn't like a fluff interview.
Yeah, no, he's terrific. He's really good. What a boring question that was.
And
I'm getting very nervous.
He was just turning the truck around.
I think he's trying to demonstrate that if for any reason you guys weren't around, there's a role for him on one of our news talk stations.
He's still there.
He's Charlie Rose. I'm Jimmy Mortgage. I don't want to lose
Jimmy Mortgage. Hey, have you checked out the XM research?
No, I was.
Eric said we did great for XM.
So here's.
But it was reported in Arbitron that we didn't do so great, and it doesn't make sense. Something doesn't.
So I feel very comfortable being able to talk about anything I know, right? So the Department of Justice.
Yeah, you're not allowed to look at that stuff until the merger goes through. I understand that.
So the first time I was able to get to XM was yesterday. So I showed up at XM yesterday, had a town hall meeting with the employees. First time I got to do that. Have not seen any, you know, contracts at all. Have not had access to any information. Have no idea about anything other than the fact that lately I've been getting emails from your fans.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Knock it off,
my God.
What are you trying to do? Ruin us?
So you should assume.
They might be Howard fans, but you can believe they're our fans. That's all I want to say.
Then that would explain it. The reason that they were doing that.
Were they positive emails? Like, congratulations on the.
Yeah. Boy, Mel, you're one hell of a guy.
Yeah.
What a great company you've built.
If you get rid of ONA, let me tell you what's going to happen. Yeah. Let me know. So, can I really fast? I listened in on the conference call on the train yesterday. I want to thank you because my elbow is sore because I was like this for an hour.
What conference call?
with the employees.
Oh,
yesterday.
Is that? Oh, I didn't know you could even access
it. Yeah, we were all listening in.
Oh, okay.
And there's two things I want to bring up. Who fainted during the meeting?
So I'm.
All of a sudden I hear, are you all right? And then you're like, yeah, whatever. Just drag her out. I got things to do here.
So good thing this is radio, so people might be able to believe what I'm going to say. So because of my startling good looks, that very often when I take the stage, women, like, you know, swoon over me
like
and collapse. So it's just scary. So we're having this room. It's a horrible facility to do it. You know, we have, you know, a whole hundreds of people cramped standing up in this thing, and at some point, I didn't know if it was a woman or a man, about halfway through it, just collapsed, and the, you know, security came and they carried her out. So after it was over, I went to try to find out what happened, and it was a young girl who works there who just fainted, and she was fine, and I asked her to go home, and she didn't want to go home, and you know I had a car outside and said, can we take you home? And no, and she,
so the people there really don't want to hear Mel say go home at this point.
And it didn't, you know, maybe you're fired for fainting.
I never used the other words.
So
basically get a clue.
So she asked, I said to her, it's happened before, she said, not since high school. So I mean, you know, it just seemed she fainted. So
and then another guy asking about health insurance. I'm like, health insurance? There's so many questions you can be asking.
So what I was shocked about is, and again, I thought you guys lost a step, okay? Because I remember in the old days when I'd have a shareholder meeting, okay? You know, there would always be, but. You know, we'd be having a shareholder.
We didn't set that. I swear,
it was just coincidental.
Of course,
no.
So
what would?
I swear on that one.
Right, and I but
we have passionate fans. I swear, we did not set up those calls.
So you know that there were those calls, right? So I'm waiting now for my, you know, Opie and Anthony questions. You know, and was sort of disappointed that I didn't get it. So in answer to it, so I have not had a conversation. In all due respect, and I mean, as important as you guys are. I had not had a conversation until I saw Eric, you know, late in the afternoon, and he had told me that there's a contract period or something coming up. This is the first I heard of it, and I know nothing about it. I don't even, believe it or not, I don't even know what you guys make today. Though I'm sure it is bizarre.
It is ridiculous amounts of money. Don't look at our contract, so, but I'll tell you, it's a lot of money.
I'm assuming. So anyway, but that's all I know.
Compared to Howard, we got 63 days left.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
And are discussions going on?
No, I bet you're chomping at the bit to maybe even get a call from Robert Eatman, super agent Bob Eatman again.
He doesn't deal with Robert Eatman.
I don't think I've ever met. I'm not sure I've ever met him.
You ever take melatonin?
So, no, but in all seriousness, there are no discussions going on?
63 days and counting.
But then no discussions? Or you're
I think the whole thing was, you know, nothing was going to be done until the merger went through. Well, so.
And I'll make sure. All I can do is make sure that.
And we want to continue. We love the freedom of satellite radio.
Yeah, and
said.
I think, you know, the people at SM seem to be happy of everything. I'm not hearing saying, thank God you're here so you could fire them. No, right. No one said that. No one has said that yet to me.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. So I'm assuming that if, in fact, you know, you guys want to stay, and if, in fact, XM obviously is happy and want to stay, all I can do is facilitate, make sure that there are conversations.
And you know, we got like a thing going on with regular radio.
Yeah,
how does that make you feel?
Well, here's my attitude on it, okay, because I've said it before. We're asking people to pay $12.95, right? We're asking them to pay for something. So the ability to the more we give them, that's the same, the less desirable it is. So if we started putting commercials on our, you know, forget those few clear channel stations that XM is stuck with, right? If we started to put commercials, as an example, on our music stations, you'd sit there and say, why would somebody subscribe to satellite radio? Because they're going to hear those same obnoxious commercials there. So the more exclusive content you can have, the better off it is. So in a perfect world, okay, where I'm going to pay a good amount of money, right, it's going to be because the only way a subscriber can get it is on satellite radio. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So if, in fact, somebody feels that they need to be on terrestrial radio, so as an example, we currently carry Sean Hannity. I'm a huge Sean Hannity fan, but Sean is on a whole lot of terrestrial radio stations, and he's on satellite radio. Without getting into amounts, you should assume the amount of money that Sean is getting paid is not really material, right? Because of the fact we love having them. But, you know, there's an AM, FM radio generally every place where there's a satellite radio. I mean, there's not necessarily satellite radio everywhere. There's an AM/FM radio. So if somebody wanted to hear something that's on terrestrial radio, they can just push the button. Now, that, and you guys, I know it's different, right? So, I mean, I know what you're doing different and stuff like that. But we had a an important performer where there was a disagreement with the programming people on how much money he wanted, and he wanted to keep doing satellite radio. And what we did was we carved out a few markets where they were on, which were not so material to our subscriber growth, right? I mean, it wasn't New York, L.A., Chicago, Philadelphia. I mean, it wasn't a top 10 market. It was sort of a few smaller markets.
This is the Bubba deal.
That's the Bubba deal. So in the case of Bubba, where, you know, we've said, okay, you want to do a terrestrial radio and a satellite radio, fine, I understand why you want to do it. I wish you didn't. I wish, you know, Sirius was able to justify the money you wanted, but, you know, it's not. So if in order for you to do what you need to do and what you want to do, and he's a terrific talent, we're going to carve out, you know, Tampa, two other, you know, markets, and he's doing that. And but, you know, why would I want Howard, you know, forget you guys because, you know, you got it committed, to be on in terrestrial radio? Why would people pay $12.95?
Right. Mm-hmm. Bubba said yesterday that if we stay with the new company, it's a deal breaker for him.
Are you guys and Bubba not?
I've never even met the guy.
Oh, okay.
I could care less.
So, I mean,
like Ant said,
he's not on the board.
Yeah,
you know,
but it's a deal breaker for him. So, well, yeah, deal breaker for the merger.
And I would hope that Bubba, you know, I think Bubba's a great talent, and you know, as I said, it disappointed me, and I went to our programming people to see if, in fact, there was a way, you know, to carve out more money for him, and what Bubba thought he needed or wanted was just more than what Sirius was prepared to pay. So this was a compromise, but it is a compromise because I don't think I don't think it's good. I think that. You know, if HBO started running commercials during those movies, you know, or during their stuff, it would look like another channel. And why do you want to pay for something? You know, you don't, I mean, you pay for CBS and your cable bill, but people don't sort of think about that. If it's just going to be another broadcast.
So basically you're saying we could do both, which is good. That's what we needed today.
Okay. So, all right, what else can I answer?
Why don't we move on with the future? So the merger happened.
So I have, just so you know, because I mean.
You're a busy man. I'm not.
This is very important, but I have and I wanted to get here fast, okay? Because I didn't want.
Where you got to be?
I have a town hall meeting with all the employees. So the same meeting at Sirius.
Okay.
So at 10:30.
Okay. All right, really fast in the future, because now the merger went through, everyone is really, really confused. Like. How is this going to work? The ABCs.
So let me give you just a few things, and I try not to bore everybody. If you combine the two companies today, we have $2.2 billion of revenue, right? Which makes us the second largest radio company in the world.
Wow.
So only Clear Channel is bigger than we are in radio, and we're growing, and they're not. If you combine the number of subscribers, we have about 19 million. The only company in the subscription business that's bigger than us is Comcast.
Mm-hmm.
So we have more subscribers than Dish Network, DirecTV, Time Warner Cable. Hmm. So we now finally have a you know, critical mass, a big company. We also are going to have some synergies, so there'll be cost savings and be making money down the road. If you're an XM subscriber, you're listening now, your radio will not be obsolete. Nothing will change, right? I mean, if you know, nothing will change. Somewhere down the road, you know, probably in the next 2 to 3 months, we're going to announce that there's an opportunity for existing XM subscribers with the same radio that they have now to be able to get some content from Sirius. Not all of Sirius, but some content from Sirius. And by the way, vice versa, the same thing. So the Sirius subscribers will be able to get select XM programming.
Are you willing to say what some of that Sirius program
would
be available?
No.
Obviously Howard.
Exactly. Obviously Howard.
Would you go something like the NFL?
So here's what I've said. So, I mean, so far, what I've said, Howard for sure, and selected sports programming and other programming. So we will, as soon as we can, because we, you know, got to look at contracts. So, you know, the first question, if I now say what's going to be available from Sirius on XM, the next thing someone's going to say, well, okay, what's going to be available from XM on Sirius? And I haven't seen a contract.
Right.
So I have no idea.
Would you like us to be heard on Sirius?
Well, if, in fact, you were with the company.
Right. No, I understand.
Why wouldn't I?
Okay.
Sure. No, absolutely.
If we were with the company.
Well, no. I mean, you're telling me you have a contract that's up, and I have no idea anything about it. But if this were today, okay, why wouldn't I? I mean, you had a large fan base. You're entertaining. I mean, you know, I think
would you keep this channel or just our particular show?
What else is on the channel?
Ron and Fez. Okay. I want to give a plug-in for Ron and Fez. What else other than Ron and Fez?
Violence programming over the weekend.
Maybe Than and Sam. No, just kidding. Ron and Fez and us.
Yeah, I mean, so I don't know
that's
if that...
That's pretty much it.
I don't know if that means a channel.
Well, we got some others, but we'd have to look at, you know, we'd have to have some discussion with the programmers, but...
So let's assume that the programming people will sort of take a look at what is available and what's possible and make the decision. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I don't know Ron and Fez well. I knew they worked for us in Washington at one point.
They're extremely talented.
I know the feedback that I got from them was terrific. I have only good things, that I've heard about them. So if, in fact, our programming people said, you know, that Opie and Anthony and Ron and Fez would be part of that offering, that sounds great to me.
Awesome.
Will my horrible, boring Charlie Rose question hurt me during negotiations?
is your contractual name the same name as you use on the air?
No.
Oh, okay, good. So this way I'll never know.
Yeah. It's not a picture on there or anything.
So, I have a question about, too, the one thing they keep saying in the papers about the iPods, and I guess content, like spoken content, stuff you can't get on an iPod is the best way to compete, because every article now with satellite, it seems like the media is just trying to shit on the merger.
So I think after this merger, right, there's just a tremendous amount of competition. I mean, I think the broadcasters are competition. I think HD radio, whatever that'll be, you know, as it evolves, will be competition. Internet radio, Wi-Fi will be everywhere. You'll get it in your car. There'll be competition. iPhones, iPods. So I think our success is that we really want to have the best content. So it's not about content. It's ubiquitous. I mean, there's plenty of content that's out there. It's having content that can't be replicated elsewhere. Mm-hmm. And that's what our mission is, right? So if you start with us today being the second largest company in this audio entertainment space, so, yeah, will there be internet radio companies? Yeah, but, like, which one is going to be our competitor? I mean, specifically, you know, if you're a stock, if you're buying a stock, Clear Channel is going to become private, so we'll be the largest, publicly traded radio company. So you can buy a Sirius. Or you can buy a what, you know, and I'm not talking of a device company. Apple's a great company and stuff like that. But what internet radio company, mm-hmm. you know, are you talking about? Or, you know, what other kind of technology? So I think we're really well positioned, to compete in the future. And I think it's real important, you know, which is why I'm here, right? I mean, I think important content is real important, you know, as long as we're smart in being able to keep our focus on that. We think it's great.
What's the next step?
The next step is to make it happen. I mean, the issue is as grueling as this has been, it's the easy part.
Right.
I mean, now it's got to work. I mean,
for the XMers, when will they be able to start listening to serious programming? So I know you said in the fall, but can you give people a taste before then?
You mean listeners? Well, no. What has to happen is that there's a certain amount of bandwidth.
Right.
That we, based on compression technology, that with you're getting everything you get now. Right, everything you get now, you'll then be able to add some selected channels, few channels, right? If, in fact, we have, let's assume that there's an XM channel that is in a similar genre as a Sirius channel, but it's a better channel.
Right.
You know, I mean, it's programmed better, and, you know, then why wouldn't we want to make it available to Sirius subscribers as well? So I think as time goes on, the content will morph toward each other.
Yeah, get rid of the redundancies.
But not just get rid of, make them better. In other words, so if we both have a 70s channel, why not make the best 70s channel from both of those and make it available to subscribers on both services?
Right.
I mean, you know, if we both are doing 5 or 6 country music channels, you know, I mean, why do 10, unless there's 10 great ones, why not do 5 really good and make them available on both services? And that's something that we would like to do as fast as we can, because the thing that we want to do is to make sure the churn, so, you know, there's you want to get additional subscribers, and then you want to keep them.
Yeah.
And I think the better our content is, right? The better our content is, the more we keep them. So that's where that focus is.
Can you tell people to start buying radios again? Because I know because of the merger, no one was buying. And I went into the Best Buys and the Circuit Cities, and those displays were like dusty, and they were pushed to the back, and because no one knew what was going on. So they're like, why am I going to invest in a new unit if I don't know what the hell this merger is going to do to me?
And you don't know how painful it was for me doing exactly the same thing, right? So, and I think what happened, and I've spoken to, you know, the CEOs of these, you know, Best Buy and Circuit City, is
is that if you think about Blu-ray DVD and HD DVD,
sure.
And consumers were confused and they didn't know which one to buy, so they didn't buy anything.
Either. Right.
Yeah. So you got now, it's like you got this AM radio and you got this FM radio, and they're sort of separate, and you don't know which one, you know, to buy, right? So the hope is that now that the merger's there, we'll be able to eliminate that confusion, be able to talk about the fact that both radios are going to work, you're going to be able to get, you know, the content, you know, the best of content, and by the way, just buy satellite radio. I mean, in other words, you know, from our point of view, I'm indifferent, you know, whether it's XM or Sirius. And the great news for the company combined is that every car company, every car company, you know, is putting, you know, these satellite radios in. Mm-hmm. And we all know from being in the radio business, if you want to be successful in radio,
gotta
it's
have
the,
it
car.
The car. And those deals were made a long time ago, and they're finally coming.
Penetration is coming up.
Finally, yeah. Because a lot of these deals were like, well, just starting in the year 2008, and it was 2005 when they made the deal. So that's going through the roof now.
So I told you guys I got to leave. But I do want to come back with the CDs I have. You know, of all of this stuff. What I want to do, and what I really want to do, is play them all, okay? And be able to have the comment of why you characterize me. Some of them I understood, but there was like, some that even I couldn't understand.
You know something? I would like to hear him because I doubt any of that was me.
Now,
I bet it was open.
You were out sick that day.
Yes, I think I was.
Or sleeping on the air.
It's absolutely terrific. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you for everything you guys have done here.
Can you give me an example?
No.
Is it real bad?
Listen, I was born, you know, in a tough neighborhood, okay? And, you know, I mean, I grew up in New York City and went to public school and stuff. And I heard words that I had to go to Howard to ask me what they were.
Oh, boy. Well, maybe we start over now.
Sounds like a good idea.
Maybe we start over.
We say goodbye to Mel, and we thank him for coming like gentlemen, and we take a break, and then we all just go wipe sweat off our hands.
Yeah. Mel, two things. Who does our agent talk to? Who's the boss?
And we'll announce that tomorrow, okay? What's happening is that the assumption is going to be...
So someone will get a hold of Bob, I'm assuming, at this point.
Yeah. So why don't we leave it that...
Like that. Okay, and the second thing is...
I'll have somebody do that.
Can we take the rest of the day off? Because this was a really tough interview for us.
And now that you're working for me, I don't know exactly what your schedule is, but if you're making a lot of money, I would assume that this is a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week gig.
Yes, constant.
There you go. All right, guys, thanks. And thanks for everything you guys have been doing. You've been helping us get a lot of subscribers.
Mel, it was a pleasure seeing you again.
Take care. Thanks.
Yeah. Mel Robinson, everyone. Thank you, Mel.
We'll be back.
That's great. Thanks.
All right, we'll take a break.
Time, okay? But, I mean,
no, go. We're taking a break. We'll be back.
Shock jerks. Opie and Anthony.
Rich, were you listening to the big interview with Mel Carmen?
You know what I liked the best? How you turned, and it was right. It's true, though, and I never realized this about you, about the Howard thing. You guys were just on the defense.
Oh, that was a lie. Stop.
Huh?
That was a lie.
I know, but how he made it look so real. I was really amazed at that interview. Just listening. If I was in the car.
You're amazed at a pinwheel retard.
That's true. It's true.
My Charlie Rose question, I thought.
Yes. That was such a please.
Well, that was a joke.
Get off of this.
Charlie Rose a nice guy? But then he called me out and said it was a boring question. That's good. It's a good sign. First day on the job.
What the hell's he doing on one of the shows?
Exactly.
My platform.
Yeah, get the chinless dullard off the air.
Hey, show. Where's Don Wicklund? Don, lucky to still have a job, Wicklund.
Well, he might have been fired on the...
Did he fire you on the elevator,
Did he fire you on the elevator or in the hallway or something?
No.
I didn't want to kid about it because it's going to be ugly for XMers in the near future, but...
Real soon?
Some serious people, too, but probably much more XM.
But I didn't have the heart to ask him that because there's some good people that are going to be out of work down there.
I wanted to ask you about the shitty logo.
There's a reason Mel left for the day, I'm thinking.
But you have a new
logo? He was there yesterday. He's going back tomorrow.
Yeah, yesterday he did the town hall meeting with everybody.
He's waiting for the wolf.
What?
Right?
Yeah, the wolf.
The wolf to kind of clean up all the blood and stuff, and he'll be back tomorrow.
The wolf will be here shortly. He's a businessman. Always has been. He's all business. He knows the deal.
You like the interview, Donnie?
You know, I was really impressed. Opie, seriously. I think you guys did a great job. Oh, you asked the greatest questions.
Yeah.
He answered everything.
He's very
I thought it was very helpful when I mentioned
the most frustrating part.
Yes.
Because during a process, there's a lot of frightening parts. And I felt that really bringing it home.
What was the most you wanted to know? The most.
If anybody out there could have seen what a douche I was holding my pen. He should have taken it and fucking stabbed me in the throat.
He probably wanted to.
I was holding the pen like a gentleman's about to ask a question.
Excuse me, a gentleman is asking a question.
Gentleman's question, if I may.
What was the most frustrating part?
No, I stressed the, because the most would have made me sound like an asshole.
What was the most?
What was the most frustrating, implying that there were many, but what was the most? I even tapped my pen like this.
You know,
that commands
you
power.
Douche.
Mel, what was the most?
His next interview, you're the answer. What is the most frustrating part of the O&A interview? You know what? You get it? I'm so glad I walked out.
I wish I was 20 feet tall so I could just bite through you.
That was a good line if I would have delivered it.
It was good to see Mel in the short chair.
He looked like a little kid.
And then and fucking
that helped us actually.
But then Steve comes over.
He looked like the kid in Fast Times at Ridgemont High, like, you know, at the table on that date.
Steve comes over and basically takes the headphones off of Mel's head, and Mel like grabbed them like, "Hey, you fucking fruit, get your hands off me." Hey, Steve, why don't you tackle him and make the headphones fall off that way? Mm. I thought that I would help him.
Let's go to the phones. They're chomping. Darren, North Carolina.
Yeah, the whole time Mel was talking, all I could think about was little Jimmy's Mel Carmazzi bits.
Well, that wasn't a bad one. That was basically making fun of the person who screwed his name up when I said Mel Carmazzi, because somebody that was in Congress, what he was doing that, didn't have his name right. Mm-hmm. And it's like, it's not a hard name to get.
Yeah.
Steve, what are you doing?
They're whispering about things that men of their ilk understand.
We're getting the audio out to XM's PR department.
It's racist.
Texas PR department.
Yeah, it was so funny. I really wanted to introduce Steve.
Hello, Mr. Carmazin.
I had the chance outside, and I didn't do it in a stupid voice. So
You might know me from my band Foundry.
Hi, Mel. You'll know me for the next 3 weeks. You'll see me no more. No, it was just funny watching you pull the headphones off of him.
Because he was wearing one. Did you see how he put them on his head?
Ripped his ear off.
Yeah, no, I didn't.
I'm sure he knew it was not right, and he was fixing it. No, but then you rushed in there and just kind of grabbed him off his head.
I fixed it for him.
It was a hat on
fire.
It was
courteous.
Could the pest help us out? We're going to say some fine things about Mel Carmazin, and we need these tapes sent over immediately.
Oh, they'll edit them, make them sound horrible.
Nice things.
Horrid people they are.
We should have claimed, they edit that crap. It's not true. Let's say hi to Jeremy in Cleveland. Jeremy.
Hey, boys, just wondering if your jaws are hurting from all the love fest.
All right. It was nice.
What are we supposed to do? Curse out? Hold on. Let's be realistic here for a second. What are we supposed to do? Curse out the CEO, the new CEO of the company we work for?
No.
Answer me.
You cuss them out, but, you know, you guys, they kind of backed out.
But what? What did we back down on? What did we not address? We addressed everything. We taught, what were we supposed to do? Get in his face? Give me an example.
You guys ditched Ron and Fez talk pretty quickly. You moved on quick from that.
We what?
We mentioned Ron and Fez. Oh, hey, they're a very talented show.
Hey, fucko!
What the fuck are you talking about?
Hey, fucko! We didn't have to mention Ron and Fez. It was never going to come up, you fucking asshole.
Yeah, fuck Ron and Fez in their fuckholes.
You're such a
dick. Sorry, guys. I wasn't trying to, like...
Jeremy, go fuck yourself.
Now you're nitpicking.
We purposely made sure we brought up Ron and Fez, you idiot. That wasn't going to come up in this discussion. And go fuck yourself.
Mel said, who's on the channel? Opie and Anthony, and who else? Ron and Fez, and then Oakwood, and they're a really talented show. He goes, yeah, I had good feedback on them. And then Mel said, all right, well, who else? Like, he's looking to know what the channel content is.
I went back to Ron and Fez again. That guy's a dick.
Jeremy...
Let's
was
go to
his
Bill.
Name Jeremy, that guy?
Bill in West
the
Virginia.
Fool.
Bill.
How you doing? I can't believe, Jimmy, you're the greatest.
Thank you.
When Steve came in and said he was cutting up sound bits for XM's PR department and you called him racist.
Yeah. I just don't think that XM, SiriusXM should move on in that direction with breaking departments down by race. Same joke twice.
Good.
That's my gift.
Let's go to
Charlie Mike. Rose, a nice guy. I'm Ted the bad question asker.
Ted.
Mel, do you have a satellite radio that you like to hold? Oh, was I a nervous Nelly? Ted the bad question asker. I'm a fool. Is Charlie Rose taller than me? God almighty. Was it chilly in his studio? Comment. God, am I awful.
Brian in Philly.
What's up, boys?
Hey, Brian.
not buying that whole bit. At the end of 60 days, I think you're hearing, You're fired.
Absolutely not. He never would have showed up. Mel, the way it worked was Mel. We heard Mel's coming in. And we kind of bothered he didn't go through Roland, but we figured, all right, look, Mel wants to come in.
Do you want Mel Carmazzi? Mel Carmazzi.
But the thing was, it was like, that was a great thing. I mean,
show of good faith is what that is.
It was
in
cool.
the business world, it's a show of good faith.
He came in and sat for 45 minutes. He didn't need to do that.
No.
So, you know, no, we're not getting fired, dude. And I never thought we would. Why would you throw off a show? Especially when I always raise the tough questions.
Oh, you're great.
Mr. Mel.
Yeah, I really...
Most frustrating. The most frustrating.
Someone should have put a fucking fish hook in me and caught a bass with it. Fucking worrying nothing.
Mel Faversham.
It could have been worse. We could have had Rich Voss in here. Now, Rich.
Oh, that would have been so bad.
What would you make believe Don Wicklund is the great Mel Karmazin? I'm calling him the great Mel Karmazin now. Make sure you get that tape off to Mel immediately. Now, Rich, what would you say to Mel Karmazin? You got a chance to make an impression. What would it be? Go ahead.
Well, in the future, could you see Opie and Anthony and Howard on the same channel, one in the morning and one in the afternoon?
Let's see. One of them watched 12 hours apart.
That's a good question.
It's called an AM/PM joke, Rich.
Actually, that was a good question. I can't falter for that. Maybe we should ask that. Who knows?
You know.
No, I think he sort of explained it. But basically, there's nothing in it for him or the new company to just throw us on Sirius. But if you throw us on Sirius and make, you know, them pay to hear us, then you're getting more revenue into the new company.
And here's the next question.
And the same with, you know, their programming over here. Just throwing it on XM is not going to really help.
Well, what I don't understand, and maybe I got this wrong, I thought throughout the last couple of years, XM had more subscribers than Sirius.
They did.
They did. Then how, with more subscribers, would Sirius be able to take over XM?
Well, it
has
something
to do with debt restructuring as to why it worked that way. And Mel was probably the stronger CEO. Not to knock the other ones, but I mean, come on, he's Mel.
It's a debt thing.
And it's a debt thing, but it's also Sirius caught up. Them adding Howard was really, it was a smart move.
They never caught up.
No, but I mean, compared, XM didn't continue to beat them by as much as they had.
They were closing the gap big time.
Yeah, that's actually said, closing the gap.
Did Mel have to do paperwork? I'm assuming Master Poe made him do paperwork.
Sit down.
Yes.
Let's say hi to Kevin in Houston,
Mel,
Texas.
I have to search your bag.
Kevin?
Yeah, hey, what's up, guys?
Hey,
what's up?
Hey, great show today, really. I got to tell you, I really respect Mel Karmazin now for coming on the show, but I got to tell you, these fucking listeners out there that bash you guys for, you know, not asking the tough questions, shut the fuck up. Quit listening if you don't like it.
It's amazing.
It's so goddamn irritating.
They're not fans of that point. They're not fans of the fuck up people. Sorry.
It's like, what question should they have asked?
Let me just jump in. They're not fans of that point. They're haters. There's a lot of haters that are disguising themselves as fans, and the show's not going to change. This is what it has become. And if you don't like it anymore, the show's